Good morning. It's a pleasure to be with you this morning, Pam and I. Please bear with us. We're enjoying it with our apologies. Thank you for listening. Let us live as those who are free, not, however, as though your freedom provided a cloak for wrongdoing, but as slaves in God's service. O come, let us worship and bow down.
Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker.
Let us worship the Lord and sing hymn 130.
Hear us as we pray together the prayer your beloved Son taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You should see on the screen a picture of a rather beautiful woman, Audrey Hepburn. I'm hoping most of you here today know about Audrey Hepburn. She's a very iconic woman, and later on this morning, Pam's going to tell us about two very iconic women from the Bible. Audrey Hepburn was born Audrey Rustin. She was an actress, fashion icon, and philanthropist. Born in Brussels in 1929. Hepburn said of her early childhood that it was sheltered and privileged. However, at the age of 10, her father left them in 1935, and she stated that this was the most traumatic event of her life. And given what happens later in her life, that's quite something to hang on to. The father was worked for a loans company, and by all intents and purposes seemed to be very, very wealthy. They did well, and she spoke many languages. The mother moved the family from England back to the Netherlands in 1939, hoping that the Netherlands, as had happened in the First World War, would remain neutral. The rest, as they say, is history, and the family suffered greatly during the occupation. And indeed her biography is worth a read. The film Roman Holiday was her very first great success, as most of you will know, and she became a much sought-after actress, winning many, many awards. She was of course admired for her beauty by men and women around the world. Research tells me that she was asked on so many occasions to reveal her beauty secrets, that she eventually wrote a poem. Some records say that it was read at her funeral, but I couldn't substantiate that, so I stand corrected if I'm wrong. obviously she refers in the poem to the beauty of women, but for all you gentlemen out there, I think the belief will still work. So here is what Audrey wrote in response to the question of her everlasting beauty. To have attractive lips, pronounce the words of kindness. To have beautiful eyes, look at what beautiful people have in them. To stay thin, share your meals with those who are hungry. To have beautiful hair, let a child pass his hand over it every day. To have beautiful maintenance, walk knowing that you are never alone, because those who love you and have loved you accompany you. People, more than objects, need to be repaired, tended, revived, claimed and saved. Never reject anyone. Think about it. If one day you need a helping hand, you will find one at each end of your arms. As you get older, you will realise that you have two hands, one to help yourself and the other to help those who need it. The beauty of a woman is not in the clothes she wears, her face or her way of fixing her hair. The beauty of a woman is seen in her eyes, for it is the open door in her heart, the very source of her love. The beauty of a woman is not in her makeup, but in the true beauty of her soul. It is the tenderness that she gives and the love and passion it expresses. The beauty of a woman develops with the years. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think if we only take one of these sentences today and hold it with us, what a difference we could make as iconic men and women. God bless. We're now going to join together and sing hymn 559.
Boaz replied, I have told you all about what I have been told about what you have done for your mother and your mother-in-law since the death of her husband. How you left your father and mother and your homeland and came to live with people who did not know you before. May the Lord repay you for what you have done. May you be richly rewarded by the Lord and the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge.
Thank you.
This reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 to 7. As God's workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain, for he says, in the time of my favour, I have helped you, and in the day of salvation, I have helped you. I tell you now, this is the time of God's favour, now is the day of salvation. We put no stumbling blocks in anyone's path, so that our ministry will not be disgraced. Rather, as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way. We pray for endurance, in troubles, hardships, and distresses, in beatings, imprisonments, and riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger, in purity, understanding, patience, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit, and in sincere love, in truth, speech, and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left. Amen.
She doesn't have a lot going for her, but she is brave.
and her faith never wavers. And yet, the life of a foreign widow who has nothing becomes so important that it's included in the Bible, and her name recognized in the lineage of Jesus. As we read through the book of Ruth, we don't find anywhere the mention of God's voice thundering down on it, and we don't hear anything of miracles like the Red Sea parting or a bush burning. But what you do find is an ordinary and challenging life, shaped by a trustful faith and guided by the God she firmly believes in. And today we are able to look back and see the mighty way her life was used for the greater good. Whilst there are many lessons to learn from Ruth, I have selected a few that stood out for me. There is hope even in the most difficult times of our life. The book of Ruth begins by looking at Naomi. After moving to Moab with her family, death separates her from them. It seems that her whole life crumbles. In fact, when she returns to Bethlehem, she tells everyone, "Call me not Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty hath dealt very bitterly with me." Mara is actually translated from Hebrew, and it's translated to say bitter. So Naomi was telling people she was bitter. I can only imagine the pain she was in to lose her husband and her sons. We have to remember here that Ruth had also lost her husband. She left everything she knew to go with Naomi. When they arrived in Naomi's native land, they didn't know how they would survive. But Ruth had faith that somehow everything would work out. They had hope for the future. Naomi felt God had dealt her a bitter blow, yet she continued to hope and have faith. Ruth laid aside her own pain, her home and family, instead turning to face the future with hope as she journeyed to a new life with her mother-in-law. Both of these women showed tremendous faith and clung to the belief that better days were ahead. When life throws us curveballs, it's not easy to hope. It's hard to have faith. But in reality, when things are tough, that's when we need faith and hope more than ever. When we look at the book of Ruth, we can see that even when we can't see beyond our troubles, we can have faith in God and hope our story isn't over. Better days are coming. The past is not our final destination when we trust in God. At the beginning of the book, Ruth is living in Moab, her home nation. Moab was a place that most Israelites didn't like. It was an enemy nation, and Israelites tended to look down on the Moabites. On top of that, she was a childless widow who lived with her mother-in-law. The journey to Israel must have been very daunting for the two ladies. Ruth made a choice to stay with Naomi and help and care for her, all the while knowing that she was going to a country that wouldn't like her very much. Her country of origin already had made her an outcast, and being a childless widow gave her plenty of reason to shrink into a shell and live her life in obscurity. But not Ruth. She declared her dedication to Naomi, left everything and everyone behind, and refused to let her past hold her back. She chose to serve God and firmly believed there was still life left for her to live. No matter our past, we still have a purpose. Our past is not our final destination when we have faith. While our confidence may sometimes waver, God's promises do not. Often doing the right thing
means sacrifice. Naomi told Ruth she was free to go back to her homeland and her beliefs to find a new husband that would care for her. Even when her sister-in-law left, Ruth chose to stay with Naomi, showing not only her dedication to Naomi, but also the God of Israel. It was a sacrifice for Ruth. It would have been easy to go back, but she chose to go on with Naomi. Her commitment to Naomi was a beautiful, selfless act and an example of the love of Christ, the same Christ that would be her bloodline years later. I'm sure that we will never have to make the same kind of sacrifices that Ruth had to. But if we make a few small sacrifices, we could make a world of difference. We must keep our strength of character, even and especially when we think no one is watching. Ruth had no idea that millions of us would read her story. She lived a simple life, yet she showed incredible character. She went above and beyond in the way she honoured and respected Naomi. And in doing so, became known in the entire city as a virtuous woman. She worked hard to provide for herself and Naomi. This showed great strength of character. And because of this, she was honoured by God. We too should strive to be men and women of integrity. God uses unlikely people for his purpose. Ruth was a poor, hurting outcast. She grew up in an evil country. She was childless. She moved to a foreign land where she knew no one apart from Naomi. They struggled with poverty. If you were to look at this young woman, you would never have guessed that God would choose her bloodline for the line of our dear Lord. Ruth reminds us that no matter what lies in our past, and no matter how difficult the circumstances, a trustful faith can make all the difference. Even when we can't see beyond our pain, our anger, dismay or sorrow, we can only hope our story isn't over, that better days lie ahead. You never know. If we continue to have faith and walk with God, maybe one day someone will be telling our story. We maybe don't always see what God is planning for us, but we can be sure that he is our guiding light. I want to leave you today with this, and it's from Proverbs, and it's Proverbs 3, verses 3 to 6. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Thank you.
Let us please stand and say the Kyrie and say the Creed of the Lord. I am not what I do. I am not what I have. I am not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. It is who I am. No one can take it from me. I do not have to worry. I do not have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world.
We're going to continue with worship and sing hymn 578.
Thank you. Hazel may be well and strong for her upcoming surgery.
pray for all those who care for us in whatever capacity. We pray for the youngsters who return to school and university, and for all adults who have contact with them and therefore influence in their lives. We pray for all those who face a change in their lives, Father, with retirement, and in particular for our own dear Kay. We take a minute now, Father, to bring our own prayers to you. Lay your hand on each and every one of us, Father. Know that we strive to do our best by you each minute of every day. In Jesus' name, we ask all this of you. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is hymn 535.
Thank you.